Today is that when Bob Hutcherson starts to speak, we all listen. And that is because he's a very thoughtful farmer, and we're very proud to be working with him and for all the time he puts in to work with us. But what he asked us to do was organize some discussions about the Choptank. So we're here today to learn more about the Choptank and hopefully to generate some shareable information with the other watersheds in the Chesapeake Bay. And although we often think of the Choptank as purely an agricultural watershed, under the watershed implementation plans, all sectors are required to make changes and improvements in water quality. So today we're not just listening about the agricultural community, but we're also listening about the urban sector. And although the Choptank doesn't have big urban city centers, it does have growing towns. So there's something for us all to do in the Choptank. So for this session, we're going to learn from some state and local presenters about activities that are going on to improve water quality in the Choptank from different perspectives. First, come along. Or are you waiting in the wings? Jim George with MDE is going to talk about waste treatment plant upgrades and stormwater best management practices in the Choptank. And then, unfortunately, Leslie Grunden is unable to join us. She's unwell today. But she sends her accolades, because to present on her behalf is Eric Buehl and Jennifer Dindinger, both with University of Maryland, one with the Sea Grant Extension and one with the Regional Watershed Restoration Specialist. And they're going to do the presentation from the Caroline County about BMPs and the Choptank. Jason Keppler from the Maryland Department of Agriculture, Office of Resource Conservation, is going to talk about agricultural BMPs in the Choptank. And Jenny Rose is going to talk about extension specialist with University of Maryland, is going to talk about nutrient management plans and so how they've changed over the years. So I just want to remind you that the bios for all of our speakers are in your packages. So please take a few minutes to read about our presenters. Sorry. And first of all, we're going to hear from Jim George. So
thanks everyone for coming, and thanks to the Hugh Center for Agro-Ecology, Bay Foundation, Maryland Agriculture Associates, Lynne, Maryland Extension, and the University of Maryland itself for this event. It's really great for me. I spend so much time with the Chesapeake Bay scale of thinking to look at a smaller scale, and it's something that my program is very interested. I'm with the Science Services Administration of the Department of Environment. One of our major responsibilities of that administration is the Clean Water Act, elements that involve setting water quality standards, assessing the water quality relative to those standards, and identifying those waters that are impaired, and then establishing total maximum daily loads for those waters, and then playing a role in terms of looking at the broader system, all the elements that need to be brought together in order to take steps to achieve the water quality standards. So I also want to acknowledge a couple staff in SSA who put together the presentation, Greg Sandy and Vimal Amin. And with that, I'll start going through. Well, I think several of the other speakers have really given a good geographical context for this day's discussion. So I'll move past this. Talk a little bit about water quality in general. The program, the administration I'm with, has a strong focus on water quality. Some of the good news, at the top, there are some high quality waters in the Choptank that, as defined by the Clean Water Act, Tier 2 waters. These are the waters that are given special anti-degradation protection status. And these are non-tidal streams. So keep that in mind, that there are areas that are such high quality that they demand extra protections. They're not allowed to degrade down to their water quality standards. Some of the challenges are identified here by the impaired waters, some of which for which we've developed TMDLs, the Chesapeake Bay tidal waters for nitrogen, phosphorus, and sediment, Tuckahoe Lake for mercury, La Trappe Creek for phosphorus and BOD, Town Creek for nitrogen, phosphorus, and BOD, and then a number for fecal coliform, and some of those are for shellfish harvesting areas. We also have non-tidal streams that aren't so healthy, and we've used biological stressor identification techniques to identify what the problems are in those. In the lower Choptank, it's primarily nutrients and sediments. In the upper Choptank, it's sediments and channelization. Clearly what's happening in the upper is affecting the lower. And there's some additional listings. You might be familiar with the Clean Water Act's 303D list of impaired waters that are identified there at the bottom. One that stands out is PCBs and fish tissue. Interestingly, a lot of the PCB problems are from atmospheric deposition. I think you've seen the land uses. You're somewhat familiar with the breakout. Clearly, developed land is one of the smaller geographic areas. Within that, though, two-thirds of it is low-density residential. Those of you in the area are probably familiar with that. Interestingly, the urban areas are close to tidal waters, with Cambridge and Easton in the lower portion and Denton somewhat central. And that's natural because of the history of the area being so closely tied to the water. Only about one-third of the urban area has stormwater treatment. You may be familiar with Maryland's stormwater laws. They came in effect 1985, so about two-thirds of the development occurred before 1985, which accounts for why about a third of it has stormwater controls on it. This means that the remainder is subject to potential additional stormwater management retrofits. This is a breakout of the loads, clearly again dominated by agriculture, as is no surprise here, though urban has a significant part of that. And septic systems are somewhat noteworthy and can have localized effects. So I'll get to wastewater in a bit, but note that it's a fairly small load here, and that's in large part because of significant progress being made on that. Some of the programs that are in place that we somewhat take as routine at this stage, or some of them, are credited with why things are to some degree in the urban area, at least in general land management area, making progress. The Forest Conservation Act of 1991 ensures that some degree of forest is maintained or even planted, if it's not even there, if there's development on crop fields. And that's a good program in place that is routine in happening with all development. The Maryland Bay Restoration Fund has been a major contributor to bay restoration and Choptank improvements in terms primarily of wastewater treatment plant upgrades. I mentioned our stormwater management since 1985, and it's continually improved, with the 2007 being the latest iteration of refinement of that. The 2009 Chesapeake Bay Trust Fund is a great source of resources for non-point source restoration projects. The Fertilizer Use Act of 2011, although we're having some challenges documenting exactly what the impact of that is, it's generally acknowledged that it's having a major impact reducing phosphorus from large lot residential land, of which there is a fair amount in this watershed. And then the Sustainable Growth and Ag Preservation Act, known as the Septic Bill, loved by some, hated by others, is playing a role in terms of making us think about where we develop on septic systems versus on existing sewer systems. This gives a kind of a visual perspective on load reductions since from 1985. Many of you may be aware that 1985 is kind of the baseline year for tracking and evaluating progress in the Chesapeake Bay, primarily because it's back then that they started developing models that allowed us to estimate loads from the watershed. And you can see wastewater loads have gone down significantly. Septic loads and urban stormwater loads have gone up for phosphorus and nitrogen and sediment, the same pattern. Of course, septic systems are primarily don't discharge phosphorus, which gets bound to the soil, so you don't see septic systems showing up in the phosphorus and sediment examples there. This is a bit busy slide, but it does indicate some information that you can look at more closely. There are three major and eight minor wastewater treatment plants in the watershed. All three of the major plants have been upgraded to ENR. So for those of you not familiar with wastewater treatment plants, thinking of nitrogen, your typical plant with secondary treatment is 18 milligrams per liter. Back in the 1990s, there were upgrades done that took it down to 8 milligrams per liter, and the ENR upgrades are taking it down to 4 milligrams per liter. So significant progress has been made, and there's progress now shifting to the minor facilities, some of which are being upgraded. Three are in process right now to be upgraded. They're not as cost effective as the major plants, which is why they end up being next in line. Stormwater restoration or stormwater management. You can see this shows locations of stormwater facilities by types. You can look at it. I believe these presentations are going to be available to you to look at more closely, but it gives you a sense of there is some progress taking place, and that tracking and reporting of that is very important for the Bay restoration effort in general. Septic systems, again, we have a fairly good idea of where they are now, in part because the Bay Restoration Fund has a revenue generating that bills people that are on septic systems. You can see that there have been best available technology upgrades, 627 in the critical area, that area close to the tidal waters, and 244 outside of the critical areas, and 40 septic system connections to sewer systems. And that pretty much wraps up my presentation. Happy to take questions if you have them later on.
Thank you very much. If you join the rest of the panel over there, Jim. At this time, I'd like to hand the podium over to Eric and Jennifer. The comments from Leslie is that these two, without these two, Caroline County wouldn't have achieved anything. And she has great respect for the work that you've done and wants to thank you both for it. So, thank you. Do you have a presentation?
Yes. We didn't pay Lynn to say that. She just figured it out. Thank you, everyone, and I apologize again that we are not Leslie Grunden. We could nowhere ever be Leslie Grunden, but we will do our best. So Eric and I are here to talk about the work that Caroline County has done, sort of even pre-TMDL. Eric and I are watershed restoration specialists with University of Maryland Sea Grant Extension. The two of us cover the whole Eastern Shore, and we are basically the assistants to residential and commercial and community folks who want to do restoration work. Kind of our counterparts are in the ag world, and we sort of help everybody else. So this is just the list of the types of plans and projects that Caroline County started with. These even predate Eric and I. The watershed characterization from 07 was what we used along with Center for Watershed Protection to help the county put together their 319 plan. And Leslie wanted me to emphasize that the 319 plan is really the foundation of all of the rest of the work that you see here, and they consistently go back to that 319 plan because they were able to identify projects. Having a 319 watershed plan that's EPA approved with those A through I criteria unlocks a lot of funding resources for communities that wouldn't otherwise be available. Caroline County also served as the Eastern Shore pilot for the WIP Phase 2 work and learned a lot about milestones and watershed restoration there as well. So, again, we started working with Leslie. I started doing this work in 2009 and was covering the whole shore. And for those of you who have received phone calls or emails from Leslie, you know how persistent she is and you really can't say no. But it was also a lot of fun to work with her. And so we just started by helping out creating this watershed plan. And then she would call and say, can we do some projects? Can you help us find some money? And that's what we've been doing for 8 or 9 years now. So again, this was the foundation, this watershed plan of all of the projects that Eric is gonna talk about. We have a lot of lessons learned, because that's what we were asked to talk about, the role of the local government and the lessons learned from doing this watershed restoration work. But again, the 319 plan was really what allowed the county to even have a list of projects to show to funders to say, we have prioritized our challenges and we are just going down the list and trying to do this work. So I'm gonna pass it over to Eric to talk about some projects.
Thanks, Jen, and everybody for the opportunity to be here. Sorry Leslie couldn't do it, but we'll do our best to, I think, represent Leslie. And for those of you that know her, it's a difficult task. First project I want to cover is a 319 project, and I think Jen did a good setting the stage for the different planning that's taking place in the Choptank, but I think it's important that those plans not just sit on the shelf, collect dust, or be used as reference, that they actually begin to manifest themselves in implementation projects. And Leslie went through and put a list of ones that are either ongoing or have been completed, and that the county is very proud of what they've accomplished. This one is The Caroline County Department of Public Works yard. They had a stream that ran through the middle of this facility, and so they were able to get funding to put in 5 bioretention areas to address water quality going into the stream, but also take care of a long-term flooding problem that they had there on site. The wonderful thing is how Caroline County works. If Leslie is looking for an opportunity to add in an educational component, she's on the phone to Sue Simmons at their Recreation and Parks Department, and they're able to tie into either after school programs or with students. And this was an opportunity to work with middle school students next door to learn about stormwater runoff, water quality, land use change, and native plants. And Leslie was nice enough to go ahead and put in some cases where the information's available, the load reductions, as well as the costs of the projects or the grant funding that was received. The next project is a very similar one that was done in the town of Greensboro on public property, 2 on town land and 1 at the county library. And again, bioretention facilities were installed to help water quality treatments. You all know Greensboro, it sits literally right on the banks of the Choptank River, and so these were important small-scale projects, not only to deal with water quality, but they serve as demonstration sites where we can take tours through, where people can come and see native plants and how water quality and stormwater interact. Also, again, with a couple of these practices that went in, you were resolving some long-standing flooding issues by taking care of stormwater and water quality. Next project was completed in 2014, and this was one of the first projects I really had a chance to go out with Leslie on, and it was putting in a porous parking lot at their Department of Emergency Services facility on Route 404. Now, the facility had to do its traditional environmental site design BMP, so this was above and beyond what was required because of the development that was taking place on the parcel of land. And so this was the first porous project in the county, and so it served as a wonderful educational opportunity to take people out to see that this is an option if development's going to occur. but also contractors to see the material. The Maryland Asphalt Association had their technical director out there taking video of it and has put it up on their website and has taken people out there as well, because it's kind of a unique facility to have. But again, education is very important with these projects, and Leslie worked with the county tech school to do this sign, this custom sign that actually has a sprinkler in it that it shows the water going through the paver down into the porous material and on out. So it's kind of a neat project where they had a chance to not only do some hands-on construction of the sign, but also to learn about how the best management practice worked. The next project, this is at the Greensboro Volunteer Fire Company Community Hall. This project just wrapped up thanks to 319 funding. Again, this was one where they had done their development and had to do traditional environmental site design practices, so this was also above and beyond. And rather than use the standard downspout disconnect, they were actually sent underground to a rain garden, and then there were pervious pavers or porous pavers put around the back on a patio area. And this is important because there aren't many of these traditional small-scale practices in North County that we can take people to. So this is being a highly publicly accessible site, great visibility, and it's a wonderful showcase. We had 4-H students out there or 4-H youth to help do the planting. Their conservation plantings. We're able to take people out to see the front of the building and find out that native plants can be worked into a landscaping thing. So it's multifaceted in what we're able to accomplish with just putting in a couple of best management practices. The next one I think is supposed to be the DNR Trust, or the Chesapeake and Atlantic Coastal Bays Trust Fund. She's got A, C, and B. This was for some large-scale native plantings around the county. To the best of my knowledge, I know Federalsburg and Denton were involved in this, and I believe there may be one or two other municipalities, so I apologize for leaving them out. But this involved 2,500 tree and native plants being put in. Over 100 students from Caroline County were involved in the planning of these projects, as well as a scout troop down in Federalsburg on a very cold, rainy day when these trees were being put in. And this is how the county is out there, again, looking for opportunities to incorporate not only improving water quality, but an educational component. Back in 2015, the county was successful in securing a Chesapeake Bay Trust grant, one of their mini grants, to do a stormwater assessment for a low-income African-American community that sits on the edge of the town originally. It's in county-owned land, or in county land, but not within town proper, and they receive a considerable amount of stormwater from the town originally. And so this was something that they got a contractor to go through, or an engineering firm, to do an assessment and come up with a concept. And at this point, the favored design is a 7-acre wetland restoration and enhancement project. So we'll be moving forward with trying to find funding to begin actual full construction plans and implementation. But what's interesting is, because of the hard work of Leslie, there are a lot of absentee landowners on this property, or in this area. It's an old subdivision from about 1910. And through her, like Jen said, her persistence of phone calls and things, there's 100% buy-in from all these properties you see adjoining so that we can get a drainage easement going into the restoration site. But some of the absentee landowners were completely unaware of the plight of the people living back in this community every time that you got probably about a half inch of rain. And there's 100% buy-in from those folks to the fact that they're donating easements, and several of them are actually going to donate their land to make this project come true. So not only are we addressing water quality, but it was a quality of life issue for the people living in this area. This is one that is just starting to sprout legs in the town of Greensboro, and I've got to give them kudos for being very progressive and going after grants to do projects. Some of you know where the old carnival grounds were down on the banks of the Choptank River, where there is a public boat ramp. They've gotten some funding from the DNR Trust Fund to go into that 6-acre park and do some stormwater retrofits, wetland restoration, and cleanup. There's also going to be some rain gardens, conservation plantings, and some constructed wetland to deal with parking lot runoff before it goes into the Choptank River. So this is a great site, high visibility right on the river, and should make a big impact. The next project, back in 2013, Caroline County worked with Extension on a National Fish and Wildlife Foundation project where Jim Lewis, the senior agent with Caroline County Extension Office, went out into a field, constructed some drain fields and test plots, and planted them with switchgrass and fescue, and since that time has been monitoring both the soil and biomass on for nitrogen and phosphorus uptake. And this was all done to find out if there were affordable alternatives to the BAT systems that were out there. And at this point, it looks as though the early results are indicating that they're comparable to some of the BAT systems out there. I believe this is the last project. The county worked with one of the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation technical assistance providers to go ahead and begin doing an assessment of all the school properties in Caroline County that do not have stormwater management facilities. So that'll be kicking off here in about 2 weeks, where a group will be going around doing the assessments, and this will result in both a cost and load reduction estimates, but also some concept plans and a priority list. So things are going to be moving forward on all the school properties that you've seen. And with that, I'll turn it back over to Jen.
Thanks, Eric. I just have two quick slides. I apologize for taking an extra moment. These are just the take-homes that Leslie wanted everyone to understand about these kinds of projects. Understanding that whenever you have an opportunity to bring in the next generation or even this generation and provide education. So every time there was a project, Leslie called and said, I want to do not just a project, but I want to make it a community engagement effort. And also that there's a lot of money being put into these small reduction urban loads. And what she asked is that with respect to things like septic upgrades, which can be quite costly, why can't there be more of a bring the money to the county and allow them to figure out where they could spend the money to get sort of best bang for the buck, but also improve the life of the community members. Knowing your audience, so she gave me some statistics about Caroline County. You may know this as well. The per capita income in Maryland's about $50,000 a year. For Caroline County, it's about 30. The Templeville, Henderson, Marydell area in the North County is 10, 11, and 12, respectively. So there is not a lot of residential funding available. And if you can invest in things like wastewater treatment plant upgrades and attach failing septic systems to them, that also allows people to then improve their homes and improve their businesses and actually brings in community development and community engagement as well. So there's a lot of value added to investing in these projects that you may not see in the sort of high cost per pound reduction, but this investment is also helping your communities to become stronger and to become more sustainable. So thank you.
Thank you both. There's obviously a lot happening in Caroline County. At this time, I'll turn the podium over to Jason Keppler with the Maryland Department of Agriculture. And certainly, as we talked to Bob and his 41 practices carrying out, we felt that as there's a conservation tracker at the Department of Agriculture, that it would be good to hear the specifics of what practices have taken place. So Jason, give us the lowdown.
Well, thank you very much for having me today. I have the dubious honor of taking what actually goes on the landscape and agriculture, all the good best management practices that are being implemented, and translating that into something that Rich and folks over at the EPA can understand that they can incorporate into the Bay model. So it's really a multifaceted effort. One is to make sure that all the BMPs that we're putting on ag are accounted for in the model. They're accounted for appropriately in terms of the load reductions and the benefits that we receive ultimately out of the model. It's also important that we account for all those best management practices to ensure that they are on the landscape and being actually doing what they're supposed to do. So it's a huge effort. We work with our jurisdiction partners throughout the Bay watershed to really look at this in a collaborative approach. So what goes on in Delaware, what goes on, obviously up in Pennsylvania, in Virginia, other places, all make a contribution. We're all working together towards this. So What I'm going to do is really start out at a high level and talk about what Maryland is doing in terms of the ag sector, and then try to drill it down a little bit and talk about some specific projects that are in the Choptank. It's important to talk about the Choptank because, as Rich indicated and Joel indicated earlier, we have the Greenboro station. It's a long-term water quality monitoring station. In fact, that's the only station that essentially the Bay Program uses to calibrate the model for the entire Eastern Shore. So whatever occurs in the Choptank will ultimately impact the ag sector as a whole over on the Eastern Shore. So unless you've been living under a rock for the past couple of years, you know that the president signed an executive order that established the Chesapeake Bay as a national treasure, and recalled the federal partners to really take a look at it again and establish the Chesapeake Bay TMDL, and obviously establish allocations and load reductions by source sector. It required each of the states to develop a watershed implementation plan. My office was working with John before John retired, John Roderick, put together this watershed implementation plan for ag, county by county. We worked with local stakeholders in each of the counties to develop this plan in terms of the numbers of BMPs that we thought we could install annually out to 2025 to meet our obligations under the TMDL. So real quick, if you look at the final targets that we had set forth, they were broken out by source sector starting in 2009 and where we need to be out to 2025. And you can see for agriculture, we were at about 20 million pounds in 2009, and we need to drop down to 15 by 2025. So you're looking at about a 5 million pound reduction in nitrogen for ag. And then for phosphorus, it's not quite as dramatic. Phosphorus is a tougher nut to crack, so it's a little bit harder to get there. We have made significant progress, and I'll show you what that progress is in a minute, but about 200,000 pounds there. So this plan that we put together, working with the local stakeholders, ag stakeholders, included a number of conservation plans. So this is somewhat different than Tom's slide earlier, but Bobby's slide earlier, but a lot of the same practices are listed in there. So these are our tools in our toolbox that we like to implement out on the farms, obviously. We set specific goals for each of those by county, and then essentially we rolled that up into a statewide plan. So for any one of these best management practices that we have listed here, we thought we could set those into milestones, achievable milestones, starting in 2013, out to 2017, and out to 2025. So it's 2 pages worth of BMPs, but suffice to say, we looked BMP by BMP in each county to see where we could achieve additional reductions. So here's the second page of those. So it was a really large undertaking by our folks out in the field. So how do all those BMPs roll up into the model, and what kind of load reductions do we expect to achieve? This is a relative load reduction for nitrogen in Maryland. So this is where we thought we could get our nitrogen reductions based on specific types of practices. Now, at the Bay Program and other places, they kind of call these the watermelon charts for obvious reasons. But all of the green slices of the pie represent the ag BMPs that are contributing to nitrogen reductions. The yellow are the urban, and then you have wastewater and septic. So you can see that a significant portion of the load reductions are coming from ag for nitrogen. Cover crops, conservation tillage, buffers, decision ag, animal waste management systems, just to name a few, are some of our heavy hitters there. Here's a similar pie chart for phosphorus. You can see the overall reductions for phosphorus are a little bit greater for the ag side. Certainly urban's contribution is great, and you can see wastewater just really has a smaller slice there. But there are different types of BMPs. We're talking about poultry phytase, the incorporation of that into the feed, animal waste management systems, conservation planning and tillage, et cetera. So some different types of BMPs, but the general picture is the same in terms of relative reductions. So how did all this shake out for us? This was our latest progress run in 2015. Starting in 85, these were the loads coming off of ag land. By 2009, out of all the work that's been done up to that point with our cost shares program, et cetera, we were able to reduce it down to that 19.7. again, out to 2017, we need to be down to 17 million pounds. You can see there's that trend downward. As Rich indicated earlier in his chart, 2014 kind of threw us for a little bit of a loop. We got new data from our ag census surveys that really increased our loads that we weren't expecting, so that kind of bumped us up, but you can see we're starting to make that trend downward again. Phosphorus trends downward, and actually in 2025 we're at or below our 2015 milestone and really our 2017 milestone. Again, what hurt us on the nitrogen side actually helped us on the phosphorus side with those ag census numbers. The poultry counts were lower than what were expected, so we actually saw a reduction based on that for phosphorus. So now to bring it home closer to the Choptank, obviously, the first thing I wanted to do is, there's a number of different slides out there with land uses that show, the percentage of ag, et cetera, but we really don't delve into, the specifics related to ag. So what I did is I took the 2014 cropland data layer that NASS produces, part of USDA, and just clipped out the portion of the Choptank watershed. Basically, it's a representation of the types of crops that are grown within the watershed. So you can see a double crop winter wheat, soybean, about 64,000 acres, corn alone, 50,000, soybeans, full season beans, 43, some grass pasture and others. So those are the heavy ag crops in 2014. And, obviously, crops, they switch, field by field on an annual basis, but I think that's just a pretty good indication of where we are within ag. In terms of BMP implementation, Lynn mentioned Conservation Tracker. In 2009, we implemented a system at the Department of Ag that allows us to more accurately capture all of the best management practices that are being installed by our conservation district partners. So what we're able to do is roll that data up into the Choptank for you today, and this is essentially implementation figures from 1985 to present. So you can see the types of practices that are installed. These more or less align with the practices that I showed earlier in the big spreadsheets for our WIP goals. So we have animal mortality facilities, 168. Conservation cover, almost 2,000. Almost 10,000 feet of diversion. Filter strips, about 10,000 acres of those. Riparian forest buffer, 1,000. 7,000 of the riparian herbaceous cover or grass buffers. So there's quite a few practices that have been installed. Wetland creation and restoration, over 1,500 acres of that within the watershed. And I'll show you spatial distribution of that here in a second. Cover crops, obviously, is a huge program for us in Maryland. We continue to have record enrollment year after year with the investments that are being made as a result of the Bay Restoration Funds and the Chesapeake Bay Trust Fund. Last year we were up close to $25 million invested in the program, over 500,000 acres. How'd that shake out into the Choptank? Well, this is just trend over time. You can see back before we had that heavy infusion of money, we were right around 35,000 acres. And you can see from there on out, it's really jumped up from 70 up to 93,000. Now, if you take that 93,000 from this past year and compare it back to the NAS data from the cropland data layer, that represents about 60% coverage of that eligible cropland acre. It's also important to mention that we're not including the small grain that's grown out for harvest. So really, if you look at the percent cover where there's something green that's grown throughout the winter on the landscape, it's probably closer to 80%, 85% cover. So waste storage facilities, just a real quick side note. I wasn't able to show individual dots like Jim did on his slides. One of the restrictions that we have with our conservation planning data is that we can't divulge or distribute the individual BMP information or plan information for an individual operation. But what we can do is aggregate that up. So what I attempted to do is just show a concentration of those practices. So you can see poultry, this is a waste storage structure, poultry operations, more or less in the lower part of the upper Choptank. You can see the trend over time with those.
prep buffers, more of a general distribution. You can see them down closer to the water and up in the headwaters of the Tuckahoe, heavier concentration with that too. Wetland restoration closer to the water. It's obviously something that would be of benefit closer to the water bodies. And I apologize for going through these pretty quick. I've been given the hook. So drainage ditch management. This is something that we've been working on in the headwaters up in the Tuckahoe. What I've done with this slide is include the Public Drains Association ditches that the department helps maintain with some assistance with the districts. So these water control structures, as Dr. Fisher indicated, not only back water up into ag fields and provide that water for crops that are being grown, but also promote denitrification. We have 66 of those installed. There's an expert panel that's been formed at the Bay Program that's looking at a number of drainage ditch management practices that are going to be incorporated into the new version of the model. So the denitrifying bioreactors, you'll hear more about that from Tim Rosen from Mid-Shore Riverkeepers in a little bit. The phosphorus-sorbent material work that we've been working with folks over on the Eastern Shore. Saturated buffers is a hot topic. Certainly those will be included into the next version, as well as subsurface drains. So real quickly to wrap up where we go from here in terms of a statewide perspective, the new version of the model is supposed to be ready for us in the spring of next year, and we'll have targets that we're going to start establishing our WIP 3 goals in 2017. So we're going to go through that entire process again to look at our load reductions out to 2025. We expect to build upon the process that we used in phase 2, reevaluate those opportunities, really what opportunities exist out there. We realize we got a lot of the low-hanging fruit with the CREP practices and some others, so that might be some challenges moving forward with new BMPs. I mentioned about the expert panels and the new BMPs that are being incorporated into the model. BMP verification, getting eyes out on the ground to see if those buffers and other practices that have been installed 10 years ago are still out there functioning as appropriate. And then obviously nutrient trading, I think, is going to become a hot button topic moving forward out to 2025 and allowing the urban jurisdictions the opportunity to look for other ways to meet their allocations. And certainly purchasing credits through the ag sector, I think, is one option with that. So here's my contact info. I'll be around all day if you guys have any questions. But thanks again for the opportunity.
Thank you, Jay. Thank you, Jason. And now I'm going to hand over to Jenny Rhodes to talk about nutrient management.
So let's see. It's still morning, so good morning. I've been asked to talk about nutrient management plans, what's a little bit about the history, the requirements, and kind of what has happened over time. So first I have to say thank you, and I want to acknowledge Dr. Trish Steinhemler from the University of Maryland. She is a coordinator of nutrient management program, and I didn't need to reinvent the wheel, so some of these slides will be from some of her presentation. So let's first talk about the history, and I do want to say one thing. You know, everything is about buzzwords now. So instead of manure, we need to use the term locally produced organic slow-released plant food. So remember that. So really the driving force behind nutrient management was the Chesapeake Bay Agreement in 1987. And you know that goal was to reduce loading in the bay. So they really wanted to look at agriculture and see, look at the nutrients and see what we could do to reduce that load. And their goal was really to have 1.25 million acres under nutrient management plans. Now, you know, first, this is the voluntary part. So in 1989, there was new staff, and they worked with the Maryland Department of Agriculture. They really looked at 14 counties that had significant animal production and hired some nutrient management planners to go out, work in the local extension offices, and to go out and work with those people and promote nutrient management plans. So in that day, it was pretty simple. I can tell you it's gotten pretty complicated, but you know, it was really, we took that, and we still take the prescription approach. We look at soil testing, we look at the manure testing, the manure analysis, and then we use the university recommendations to do field-specific recommendations. So That was kind of, you know, what we started working with. And then 92, it really expanded, additional advisors, there was some federal funding, and then all counties had a nutrient management planner in their office. And there was in the process to certify these advisors to actually be certified through the state of Maryland to write plans. So from that came, you know, working, the university working with Maryland Department of Ag and putting on trainings to be able to take the nutrient management test. Then along with that came continuing education. So between extension specialists and then extension educators, we all worked together to get that done. And then we all know what happened in 1997 with the fish kills, and then along came the Water Quality Act of 1998. I have to tell you that I came to work for Extension in 1996, and I wrote nutrient management plans for 10 years in Queens County, and my boss then, Paul Gunther, said, you know, this is just, this nutrient management stuff, it's voluntary, you know, we're going to keep on with it, but it's going to be no big deal, so we'll find something else for you to do. So I wrote, needless to say, when the Water Quality Act of 1998 came, it made nutrient management plans mandatory for anyone that had $2,500 in income or 8 animal units, 8,000 pounds on their farm. And really that focus was to look at the reduction of phosphorus and nitrogen and, you know, work with that in plans. So in 2003, the law was amended and the farmers could write their own plans, and that was really good. So then we worked, Dr. Steinhemmler, and she works with local ag agents, and we work to train farmers to write their own plan. So if you're a farmer, you could write your own plan, or you could engage someone for extension to write your plan for free, or you could pay a crop advisor to write your plan. So just some of the things, you know, soil testing is important, spreader calibration, that's one of my favorite things to do, is go out and spread, calibrate manure spreaders. And you know, for the most part, farmers know, you know, they know the acreage in the field, they know how much they're getting delivered, they know exactly what they're putting on. So what are the requirements? I just wrote down some of the requirements of the plans, and I'm going to go through a few of them, but it's pretty, so data collection. So we've got to, you know, we've got to sit down, we've got to talk with a farmer, you know, what's the field number, what's the farm name, what's the FSA number, what's the tax ID number, what did you plant last year, what did you plant 3 years ago? Is there a stream there? So there's, you know, how many acres are there? Did you plant legumes? Did you plant cover crops? So there's this whole array of data that has to be collected to write plans. So when we get to soil sampling, we've got to look at the soil samples. Who's taking the soil sample? Is the farmer taking it? Is the fertilizer company, you know, who's going to test it? Where are we going to send it? Manure sampling. When I first came to Extension, manure sampling was free. That was pretty nice, but now it costs about $50 to have one manure analysis done, and it's part of something that everyone has to do. And you know, where are we going to send that? If you're composting, that certainly has to be tested also. Depending on what type of plan we're producing, there may be some tissue testing also, and tissue sampling that needs to be done. Now, not when we first started, but the phosphorus site index came into play, so now plans have to have the phosphorus site index run and also the phosphorus management tool. So those are two different tools that have to be run side by side. Farmers are now implementing the phosphorus site index, but we'll have to start with the phosphorus management tool. And then we generate recommendations through a program called Newman Pro that was developed through the university. And then we have to compile all this. We, you know, the advisor has to go back, look, make sure that everything is right, and then sit down and talk with the farmer, go over, make sure everything of that is correct. And then part of that, if it's brand new plan, brand new operator, and when this all first started, there was a form had to be filled out, and a copy of the plan had to be sent to the Maryland Department of Agriculture. And then now also we have the annual implementation report that has to be sent. So that's on the farmer side, but you know, on the extension side, we do help farmers do that. And of course, record keeping. I don't care what we do, everything has to involve record keeping. And then just follow up, you know, the advisor working with the farmer and going back to make sure, you know, things change, weather changes. So we have to make sure that all. I just put this flow chart in here, and it's an older flow chart, but it's kind of how complicated it is. So, you know, they come in, you want to collect the data. Do they have animals? Well, you got to go one way. Well, I don't have animals, no. I'm just going to use commercial fertilizer. Well, what was your soil fertility index value? If it's over 150, okay, we've got to do this set of things. So it's just a whole complicated flow chart that has to be done. So this is, I just picked out a couple of the steps I just wanted to show you, like, you know, I talked about. These are all part of the steps of data collection, you know, farm data, field data, poultry production. So if how many animals do you have? How much do they weigh? How long do you keep them on your farm? When did you last clean out? When do you think you're going to clean out again? So these are all things that the advisor has to collect to put into the plan. And then, you know, if you've got dairy or beef, then, you know, it's the same thing. Well, let's say, do you use bedding pack? Do you spread liquid manure? When do you spread manure? Do you use cover crops? And then finding tax account ID numbers. Thank goodness we have a great state website that we can go and find those. But, you know, if one farm could have 10 tax ID numbers. So farm maps, we usually use the farmer's whatever maps he would or she would bring in. We've got to know what Watershed is, and then, of course, using Google Earth has changed, you know, everything that we do. And then you get into soil sampling, you know, the same thing. Here's all these different things. You know, what's the correct way to take a soil sample? Are you sampling a pasture? Are you sampling a conventional field? You know, where are you going to send it to be analyzed, and how do they calculate the, you know, phosphorus? Are they using malic 3? Do we have to maybe convert that? But these are all spreadsheets and different information that Dr. Steinhumbler has really worked to put together to help advisors write plans. And then when you get into manure, you can see there's, I know you can't read this, but there's a whole list of, and most of these are Excel spreadsheets and fact sheets that we use when we write plans. You know, we're going to estimate what manures may be produced on your farm, but, you know, the real records really come down to what the farmer keeps and what they report on their annual implementation report. So you can see the steps go on. There's 11 steps there that really to complete a plan, and it's, you know, it's pretty complicated, just like spreading this locally produced organic slow-release plant food. So remember that if you don't remember anything else. So some of the changes over time, we went from voluntary, you know, to mandatory. One-year plans are written pretty much now. We were writing three-year plans. Only three-year plans we have are no land operations, and really from nitrogen-based plans more to phosphorus-based plans. Phosphorus site index to PMT. We have to talk about setbacks. If there's a stream on your farm, you know, what's the nutrient setbacks? Do you have livestock? Do you have pasture? And there's a whole list of, this is another list of things that really have to be addressed. And most of these are addressed in the cover letter of what happens in a plan. Operation description, the day of the plan, how long it's good, manure sampling, soil sampling, basic recommendations, and we, you know, go on down. Best management practice have to be addressed. How you're going to apply your nutrients, and then certainly bookkeeping. And then on the implementation side, there's a nutrient management voucher that has to be done, annual implementation reporting to MDA. When can we spread fertilizer, calibrating manure spreaders and documenting them. Stockpiling manure, pre-side dress, nitrate test, fall nitrate test. So the list kind of goes on. And there is a great website, extension.umd.edu/ANMP, and there's all this information is on there. So just a few more things and I'll be done. In 2015, there were 5,489 operators, 1.298 million acres under nutrient management plans, 97.7% of them were in compliance with their annual implementation report. When audited, 70% were in compliance, and 19% of those that weren't really had an incomplete plan or expired. So with that, I'll say thank you.
Thank you, Jenny. And while I'm waiting for my questions to come up, I'll just start, Jason, with perhaps asking you one Jenny brought up the issue, the fact that there's a new phosphorus management tool versus the old phosphorus site index, and one of those requirements was that everybody had to have their soil test done and reported. Do you have any information on what's happened in the Choptank? I know it's not your department. It just seemed very appropriate, seeing as we had this discussion going on about phosphorus soil levels.
Sure. So I actually left my notes up on the podium. I'm sorry, 81%. 81% of those 80% had phosphorus index values of 150 or below. 17% were between 150 and 500, and then there's only 1% of those fields that were actually over the 500 FIV value, so really just a small portion statewide. So how does that break out for the Midshore area? Again, about 80% of the soil tests were submitted to the department, so not every soil test has been submitted, but we're working towards that and hope to have those done by the end of the year. So a little bit different numbers. So in the Midshore, only 77% were under 150, so a little bit lower than the statewide average. A little bit higher number between the 150 and 500, and it was 23%. But for those that were over 500 FIV, it only represented 0.25% of the watershed. So really a small number, really have real high FIV values, all things considered. So.
Thank you. And the next question is one I have to answer, and I can handle that easily, is will all of the PowerPoint presentations be available after today? And the answer is yes. They'll be available on the at the Hughes website. So you will have an opportunity to go there. So Jim, you're our first speaker. Can you elaborate on the status of the 8 minor wastewater treatment plants? Where are they? What is the forecast for improvement?
Yes, I can, thanks to the good work of some staff folks. So 3 of the 8 are underway with, well, one is complete, one is in design phase, and one is in the planning phase. As far as cost, I don't have that. If people are interested, I could track that down. Just find me and I'll give you a card.
Leslie shared with me that the Preston upgrade, which would go to ENR, would cost $5 to $6 million, and right now the grant money they've been able to raise is only about 53%. And that upgrade would take their outputs from 11 milligrams to liter down to 3 to 4, and that would result in about 1,000 pounds of nitrogen per year being kept out of the river.
Okay, so for Erica or Jennifer, when you engineer or investigate projects, do you calculate or consider climate change and flooding protection, sea level rise? Are you over-engineering to accommodate for future impacts? If so, how far out and how high up do you mitigate?
Well, that's sort of an easy question because we don't engineer, so that one's a little bit easy. Just to clarify our role, we are facilitators and we help connect to resources and we will help bring in engineers, but you don't want me engineering. Maybe Eric is a little better. Yes, we are starting to include some climate change considerations right now. It's tough to bring a local enough scale data to bear on these practices, and in some cases, say the shelf life of a rain garden may be shorter than a sustained impact that we would see from increased precipitation. So right now we are considering, well, if we're going to treat a 1-inch storm, why not just treat a 1.5-inch storm while we're building this so that we can spend our money now? And as opposed to having to retrofit it later. So yes, our program is also a part of the Watershed Assistance Collaborative, which is Department of Natural Resources, Chesapeake Bay Trust, and the Environmental Finance Center, and Sea Grant Extension, and that is also an initiative that the collaborative is interested in as well, incorporating climate change considerations into stormwater management BMPs. Do you want to add?
Yeah, I just would, whoa, this one works. Agree with everything Jen said. We don't do actual design, but we try to steer people towards the practice that's appropriate for the site, things like that. And usually engineering consulting firms are brought in that handle that sort of work. But we have been talking a lot about, again, rain gardens. You know, currently we're just doing the 1-inch, but do we need to be popping it up to about 1.5? So we are considering that, and again, we do have people on our watershed protection team that are working with the climate change issues, and we're cognizant. I know that when worked with the town of Betterton, that was one of the issues that we had to address to make sure that, you know, that we were looking far enough down the road, and we were using information that was available on the, I think it was the DNR website that had that available.
Thank you, Eric. And Jenny, this one's to you, although I think it's probably a Department of Agriculture question, but I'm sure you can answer it. Nutrient management plans are just plans. There is no guarantee they are being followed unless MDA audits that farm. MDA currently only audits a small percentage of farms. How can we be assured that these practices are actually going in place?
Well, someone addressed that this morning, and it's about the bottom line. So, you know, each farmer is looking at their bottom line. So really, at the end of the day, why do they want to apply more nutrients than they have to? Fertilizer is expensive, whether it's organic or inorganic fertilizer. But I have to say that, really, you know, in Maryland, farmers have really, you know, stepped up to the plate when the Water Quality Act, you know, came to bear. You know, they stepped to the plate and they said, okay, you know, if this is, you know, what's going to happen, we're going to work and we're going to implement these plans. And, you know, in this area, Howard Callahan works to go out and work with farmers. And, you know, there's always going to be, there's something, you know, that may not be right. Like I said, you know, we talked about there's a percentage that may be incomplete, something may be missing. That's why I said they're, you know, they're very complicated. Maybe they've expired and need to be done, but, you know, most farmers, on the most part, they want to get new soil samples every year to look at those trends of, you know, how soil sample is. So, again, it's about the bottom line. You know, on my farm or any other farm, we're not going to over-apply because it costs money and it costs us, you know, at the bottom line.
And I think EPA did a study of all of the Chesapeake Bay State's nutrient management plan programs and held Maryland up as an example because of the fact I think they'd done 13% evaluation last year. So, Jason, is it a problem that the Bay model uses only one station for monitoring water quality on the shore? Can we get more monitoring stations to help illustrate what we are doing as a result of this meeting?
As I indicated, it's a long-term monitoring station, so it's something that the Bay program has traditionally used. Rich could probably speak better than me on this, but I know there's a number of other stations that are coming online, but we just don't have the historic data there yet to really incorporate some of those monitoring data into the model yet. I hate to defer to Rich, but really I want to make sure that we get it right too and folks have a better understanding on it too.
Yes, Township, a very small watershed. But it's tough on the eastern shore. It's tough to find that huge flowing rivers, but we now at least have a 10-year record, so we're going to have a better sense of calibration up on the eastern shore. But we also calibrate some tiny waters. Because the waters in the Choptank are receiving those, so when you look at the tiny waters, that helps us understand both the watershed and the downstream waters. But you're right, the long-term stations on the Greensboro, but we've got more stations now across the eastern shore.
And Jason, it looks like you're popular here.
Don't sit down, Rich.
How do you follow up to make sure that the best management practices are being maintained and working efficiently? For example, how can you ensure farmers are using that water control structure and manure storage shed to maximize benefits?
Sure. So one of the requirements as we're moving forward as part of the midpoint assessment is each of the jurisdictions or states had to develop a BMP verification protocol. So we had to submit to EPA our plan to address that very issue, how we intend to ensure that best management practices that have been implemented are doing what they're supposed to do. So we've developed this this protocol and was submitted. It was approved by EPA, and essentially we're required to inspect 10%, at least 10% of our structural practices annually. So we're putting together this BMP verification team that would be independent of the soil conservation districts that would actually go out there and provide a third-party verification to ensure that those practices are still functioning as originally intended.
And then another question for you. Are there BMPs that are on the ground but are not getting credited in the model?
Yes, there are quite a few BMPs that are not currently being credited into the model. As I indicated earlier, there's a number of different expert panels that have been formed at the Bay program to look at new practices and to establish nutrient reduction efficiencies for those practices. And then once those expert panel reports are submitted and approved to the partnership, they would be incorporated into the next version of the model, so we'll be able to take advantage of those load reductions out to 2025.
And Jason, farmers are creative and willing to experiment. Is MDA working on more flexible standards for available cost share programs for various ag BMPs?
So traditionally, our cost share program that we have relies upon established NRCS standards and specification practices. So your practices that have been established by NRCS. So we know that those are effective practices, and that's why we invest in those practices. We have other opportunities, other funding sources that we can go to look at more progressive or other types conservation initiatives, things like the Natural Resources Conservation Services Conservation Innovation Grants. It's an annual grant that we've applied to in the past to look at water control structures, working with our partners like Midshore on the bioreactors and some other work in the drainage ditches. So those practices were originally investigated through a Conservation Innovation Grant. We have the Chesapeake Bay Trust through their Pioneer Grant, where we can look at practices. We looked at in manure incorporation and other types of things. And then National Fish and Wildlife Foundation has a large amount of resources available to help with those. So yeah, we tap into those. And if folks are interested in trying to apply certain types of practices on their land and want to partner with us, we'd be willing to look into opportunities to do that.
Lynne, can I say something too? I think as time moves on, farmers have to stop looking. I mean, the state is certainly going to do a lot, and they're going to do a lot of verification, but I think we need to get creative and looking. We've got a lot of NGOs that want to work with us and a lot of community people, just like, Jen and Eric talked about. So I think, we have to start thinking outside of our box and where are the other places, the things that we can do. And of course, nutrient trading, is working, in Virginia, they've done some nutrient trading. So I think we've got to, broaden our horizon and see what else we can fit out there.
Question for you, Jim. The wastewater slice of the pie for phosphorus BMPs is very small. Why is that, and can more be done?
Well, the so-called watermelon chart that was shown, you probably saw in bright red, it said that the wastewater portion of that chart was only from 2011 forward, if I'm not mistaken. And so the remainder of the chart was the progress since 1985. So there was a little inconsistency. If you would put the wastewater all the way back to 1985, it would have been a far larger chunk of that chart, I think in the neighborhood of close to half. So there was a little inconsistency in that. And part of the reason, I guess, was the chart that would show that isn't available, readily yeah. available. It's not easy to put those charts together because you have to isolate each BMP by itself and run the model to see what its effect is. If I've gotten the question right, maybe Jason, you're familiar with that issue, I think.
No, you're right. Those watermelon charts were put together as a result of our watershed implementation plan. So it's all based on the plan numbers. So it's not, like you said, going backwards in time. It's looking, for where we thought we were going to be.
And I think this is the million-dollar question of the day. Are we implementing BMPs, the right ones, and are we implementing them where they're needed?
Ag BMPs?
Of course. Yeah, it was an ag question. I took the top bit out because I thought the top bit had been answered, so I apologize. So yes.
Within the state of Maryland, between our max cost share program and our federal partners through CREP or EQIP, other funding sources, we've been working at this for quite some time. Max started back in 1985, and as needs were addressed, we have funding available to accommodate those needs and to install those practices. So having a willing partner in terms of the farming community to actually to work with the conservation districts to develop a conservation plan and then implement those practices as part of that plan, we've been doing that for quite some time. So I think we've made great strides, not only in the Choptank, but across the state in implementing best management practices. Is there more work to be done? Absolutely. I mean, you're never going to get 100%. So, you know, it's the branches of the tree are getting a little thin on the bottom, and we need to start reaching a little higher. So we'll continue to work towards that effort. And as new technologies come into play, hopefully we'll be able to address those moving forward. So.
Lynn, I would also say as research, you know, as we have the funding to do more research on the university side, and, you know, as things change, you know, at the university, we told farmers to bank the phosphorus in your soil. It's not going anywhere. Well, we learned through research, that's changed. So, you know, we went from the phosphorus site index now to the phosphorus management tool. So, you know, as long as we, you know, keep up with research and we have the funding to do the research at the land grant institutions, I think it's very important that, and then spills over into the BMPs to make sure that we are implementing the correct BMPs.
And to Eric and Jennifer, you know, a lot of discussion about the fact that BMPs for the urban sector are expensive. Is there anything that can help facilitate doing additional work on urban stormwater?
Cost share for residents to install BMPs? There really isn't, and a lot of the local governments have to seek grants. They don't have a huge tax base, and this is part of my conversation with Leslie this morning, was there's just not a lot of extra places we can go on the residential side for help with these BMPs, and there isn't really any cost share for that particular sector. So that was one of her recommendations.
And, Eric?
Yeah, and I think that an understanding by the grantors that, you know, a lot of these are infill projects, small scale, they're not going to have the big bang for the buck, and they just need to keep that in mind that as we're moving forward here on the shore, we're trying to fit them in as best possible, work with the municipalities that are proactive on these sorts of things. So just understand that they're, you know, stormwater and stormwater retrofits are expensive, but keep the money coming and we'll make a difference.
Awesome.
Can I add just a little bit to that? I think it's really important, and we're seeing this more and more, and particularly with this urban restoration, it's the co-benefits that need to be considered. You step out of the grocery store and the place is flooded, and the local community has this problem that it's trying to fix. Finally, they're able to fix their local flooding problem and get some treatment benefit out of it, as opposed to simply routing the water away from the flooded area into the stream without any treatment. So it's those types of things where we're getting combined benefits, and then, you know, tree plantings, small tree plantings might not by themselves be that much, but you've all had that situation where you go out to a cafe, there's a seat in the shade and there's a seat in the sun. Typically we're all running for the one in the shade. So we have to keep these co-benefits in mind, and I think Jen did a good job in pointing out that there are these community benefits that we have to keep in mind as well.
Well, thank you. Thank you to our panel. I'd like you to give them a round of applause. I think if there's one thing I gained from this discussion is some enthusiasm for the amount of practices that have been installed, the amount of work that's being done both at the county level and at the agricultural level. So thank you very much.